Internet privacy, the issue everyone knows they should care about, but probably don't. And why would we care? Google's collecting our data to serve us better ads? Oh no, the horror. This obviously isn't the whole picture, but it's what most people think about internet privacy. Spying and tracking is so ubiquitous online that, according to Pew Research, most Americans have given up on trying to control their privacy altogether. But just because it might be easier not to care, it doesn't mean we should just abandon trying to keep our data private, because the issue of privacy strikes at the very heart of who we are. And to figure out why, we need to go back in time. Advertising has been around since basically forever, but by the 20th century, things were changing. Advertisements weren't just used to inform you about a product or a sale. Instead, marketing campaigns were designed to build strong brand associations, which are key words and feelings that become associated with the product. For example, Coke ad campaigns focused on projecting an image that was refreshing, energetic, and social. You know, you've seen those old Coke ads. Advertisements were crafted in such a way that consumers would attach emotional values to something as insignificant as a piece of toilet paper. Existente. Between 1880 to 1920, spending on advertising grew from $200 million to $3 billion a year. And this growth wasn't just because of changing attitudes towards advertising. The renewed focus on marketing came about as a necessity. New technology led to the mass production of goods like cars, televisions, and clothing, but this increase in supply wasn't met with an increase in demand. The average American just wasn't buying stuff at a rate to justify the production. To remedy this, businesses didn't, say, reduce manufacturing. Instead, they ramped it up to reduce prices, and then turned to advertising to manipulate consumers into buying goods at an ever-increasing amount. This was the birth of modern advertising, and from the 1920s onward, the streets and the radio waves of America became plastered with signs and voices telling people to buy, buy, buy. This is a short history of advertising and consumerism, and while it seems innocent enough, it actually had a profound influence on the way we related to others and ourselves. The messages, meanings, and emotional values advertisers imbued in their brands were surprisingly powerful. So powerful that over time, our interactions with other people have become mediated by the objects we consume. For example, the clothes we wear, the phones we use, the media we watch, all these objects have become avenues for self-expression. The things we buy aren't just the things we buy, they're essential to how we define who we are. And this has never been a thing throughout the entirety of human history. Only since the beginning of mass production and mass marketing did humans start to create such personal bonds with the products they consume. This has brought us all kinds of issues, from warped body standards to environmental problems, because we're just buying so many damn things. But it wasn't all bad. Millions of people began to enjoy luxuries like cars and televisions that just 10 years before they would have never even dreamed of owning. The rise of consumerism was an essential piece to the rising standards of living millions enjoyed, but it came at a really big price. From the 1920s onward, ad spending grew exponentially, but businesses quickly reached the ceiling of what was possible with mass marketing. That's when the internet came to the rescue.
From your independent digital supplier, you can get hardware and software from one source without any hocus pocus.
The early days of the net were filled with fantasies of a future where the web was an open, democratic space that would equalize society. You don't need me to tell you that this future didn't come to pass. By the turn of the millennia, the internet had become locked down, with harmless tools like browser cookies that were once meant to make the internet more convenient being used to track your every move. Data that was once considered useless exhaust, like geodata, has become a part of the expansive surveillance network at the hands of Google, Facebook, Amazon, and the rest of the big tech giants. These ad companies utilize algorithms that piece together every bit of information they can about you since the very first day you went online, and they use that to build comprehensive profiles that can predict almost everything about you, your behavior, ideas, quirks, and most importantly here, your buying habits. With the internet, our data has become the product on the market. It's spelled pretty clearly in the thousands of pages of their terms of service you didn't read. We don't get to use these sites for free. Every time you hit enter on that Google search, you're buying access to the website, and you're paying with your information. Take this video, for example. How did you find it? If you're watching on YouTube, it was served up by an algorithm that knows you're vulnerable to clicking on a video with this thumbnail and subject matter. Maybe you're interested in social issues, or distrustful of companies and governments, or whatever it is, the algorithm is doing everything it can to get you to stay on this website as long as possible, buying more videos so it can sell you more ads and amass even more data about you. And if it wasn't for the dramatic music that's playing in the background right now, this doesn't sound too scary. The algorithm shows you content you think you'll enjoy. The more it knows about you, the better it can do its job, and the more enjoyable the experience will be. What's wrong with that, right? Well, things don't always go as planned. In the wrong hands, our data can be used deviously. Just ask Shoshana Zuboff, author of The Age of Surveillance Capitalism.
We knew so much about so many individuals that we could understand their inner demons, and we could figure out how to target those demons, how to target their fear, how to target their anger, how to target their paranoia. And with those targets, we could trigger those emotions. And by triggering those emotions, we could then manipulate them into clicking on a website, joining a group, telling them what kind of things to read, telling them what kind of people to hang out with, even telling them who to vote for.
For those who don't know, the Cambridge Analytica scandal happened back in 2016, during which Cambridge Analytica created 30 million psychographic profiles of Facebook users that they then used to run right-wing political ads during the election that preyed on people's worst political instincts. There's a whole documentary about it on Netflix, and it shows how in the wrong hands, our data can be used to manipulate us, get us to believe in lies, and ultimately shape the political future of our country. It's the reason why all these companies have taken big stances against misinformation online. But it would be a big mistake to overly focus on Cambridge Analytica. Outside of outright data breaches, where hackers can get access to your private information, the Cambridge scandal is basically as bad as it gets when it comes to data privacy. But what if we take these companies at their word, and nothing like this ever happens again? Why should we care about our privacy if these systems work as intended? Well, just like how consumerism changed human culture dramatically and made it so our consumption became tied to our identity, the internet has transformed almost everything about us. Do you remember how I said ad spending grew to $20 billion in 1920? Well, 100 years later, that number has grown to $129 billion for digital ads alone. And it shows in our consumption habits. We're consuming at a rate never seen before in human history. You don't need me to tell you about how global warming is a bad thing, but it's fueled directly by these ad algorithms that pick on every single one of our vulnerabilities to keep us consuming. If we care about the environment, then caring about our data is a natural next step. And it doesn't stop there. Put simply, our lack of internet privacy has made us addicted to the internet. Ever since the year 2000, internet usage has increased exponentially. And it's not just because technology has gotten better. No, the internet has been designed to be incredibly addictive. The average American now spends up to 6 hours a day online, with teenagers who have grown up not knowing a world before the internet have been maxing out their internet time at up to 9 hours per day. While 20th century marketing was insidious, 21st century marketing has become the center of our world, with most of our waking hours being spent and controlled by these algorithms. It'd be impossible to quantify just how deep the effect of this goes, but let me give it a try. As I write this script, millions of people in the US have lost their jobs. Tens of millions face eviction in the coming months, and half of Americans are living paycheck to paycheck. And yet the opposition movement has been small, isolated, and relatively ineffective. The movement is growing thanks to the hard work of thousands of organizers across the country, but seriously, think about it. The level of wealth inequality in this country is worse than it was before the French Revolution. You know, the one revolution where the peasants stormed the castle of the French monarchy with guillotines in hand? Yeah, we've gone beyond that. And yet there's a pervasive indifference towards our condition that you wouldn't ever think we live in the most unequal society in human history. Consider how much of our lives are spent hooked to these little ad boxes, how many hours are spent wasted on these internet circuses that make us complacent. It's definitely not the only reason we're so lethargic, but it's pretty up there. At its core, the question of internet privacy is one of autonomy. Now, I'm not some Luddite who wants to burn all our phones and computers. I like using YouTube and Twitter, and I understand that sometimes these algorithms can actually help promote social change by bringing awareness to certain causes, like what I'm trying to do now. But we need to be careful. After Cambridge Analytica, big tech has decided to take a more active role in what gets shown to us in our news feeds. YouTube, for example, has decided to censor political news that doesn't come from quote-unquote authoritative sources, which sure sounds good in theory to fight extremism, but it just means they're going to be serving up more videos from CNN and Fox News, which are literal propaganda outlets for the two main parties. Facebook and Twitter are similarly filtering what makes it to your newsfeed, which is good for hiding hate content, but their actions affect the way millions of people, probably the majority of people in this country, interface with the real world. We have to remember that the world shown to us by the internet isn't real. None of it is an accurate reflection of what's going on. And a lot of liberal writers here would talk about how the algorithm serves you content that gets you angry, that the world is actually a lot better than the internet would have you believe. It's a lot cleaner, it's a lot nicer, and a lot more human. But I'm not here to sugarcoat things. Things are bad, really bad. We're breaking records in terms of inequality. Global poverty is going up, not down. The US still incarcerates more people than any other country in the world. Look, I can go down the list, but I don't think you need me to. Point is, shit sucks. And the only thing we can do is band together, organize, and fight for a common cause. And the first step in that is securing your privacy, and disentangling our lives from these companies. Because every second we spend posting and arguing online is one second we waste not doing something important. So, hopefully I'll see you offline.